You're listening to the Legendarium Blue Team. Welcome. You have chosen wisely. Please go to patreon.com/legendarium to support the show.
I'm taking from that that you like watching people rock climb.
Back of people when they're active. That's all I'm gonna say.
Okay.
There's gonna be
a reason why I kind of enjoy football sometimes.
Welcome to the Legendarium. This is episode 238 of the Legendarium podcast. Thank you very much for joining us. If you're just joining us now, wow, do you have a lot of catching up to do? And
so
it will
much.
Take just about everything that you can possibly do.
And if you've been with us for a while, you'll say, they got to 238 episodes?
There are probably a few people. I think if there was an odds maker in Vegas, we would have really shot the odds at this point in time. And maybe they're going to revise some of their odds predictions and we can all make some money on that. Ooh. I am Todd. This is the Blue Team. I am Todd Wente. Today we have with us, we are a complete blue team. We have Megan back from the dead wearing a blue shirt, by the way. I really appreciate that.
You're welcome. I do what I can.
I'm sure Megan's mob
is
members.
Is this Megan or Megan Gola? Because you said she's back from the dead.
Oh, good call.
It's not Megan, it's Megola.
But she doesn't have the Tlalaxu eyes. So I'm kind of wondering about that.
I mean, you did just get your eyes done.
I did. I got LASIK, so I'm not wearing glasses anymore, and people still don't recognize me. You probably, if you're a fan of the podcast and you've been with us before, you heard Jack Butler joining us. Jack, say hi to the folks.
Hello, everyone. I'm honored and delighted to be here once more.
And we can tell that you're a liar. And we also have Kenn with us here starting us off.
Somebody's got to keep you yahoos in line.
Yeah.
Where's that guy?
Yeah.
That's true. We should have invited him.
He's down in southern Utah. And he's allowed us to have free reign of the studio. Craig doesn't do this very often and allow us to have free reign of the studio.
Is this the first episode that we've had where Craig hasn't been flitting around?
For the blue team?
We had one. Remember when we had that one when he was in Europe?
Oh, that's right.
And
we recorded
without him.
Well, but that was, we had Ryan too, and Ryan almost has, anyway, nobody wants to hear
anyway,
about that.
This is
they all want to hear about God Emperor of Dune, so...
Specifically, they want to hear Megan's impressions on God Emperor of Dune. We've put Erdandis off for like... two recordings now.
And we'll get to that in just a moment, but I do want to just mention real quickly, those of you that have been with us for a long time now, you know, if you want to reach out to us, you can engage us on Twitter, you can engage us on Discord, certainly on Reddit, and we're going to be getting to some Reddit questions right here in the beginning. You can also reach out to us at thelegendariumpodcast.com or thelegendariumpodcast@gmail.com.
There you go.
With any of our names, you know, Megan at or Todd at or whatever. Please reach out and engage with us. We've got a Discord chat that's fairly active as well. We'd love to interact with you. The more that we interact with you, the better we can make this experience for all of us. So there you go. Certainly Patreon is still available for those of you that might want to donate and help us as we try to find new ways of being able to engage with you. We're looking at next year at a couple of cons. I think Jordan Con, we've already started making plans for. And
yay!
So traveling out to see you all, it determines whether or not we're going to be bringing one of us or all of us or leaving the most offensive one home. We'll let you kind of campaign as to which one is the most offensive. So we've got Megan finally. Megan, why don't you talk to us a little bit about what you thought, your initial impressions of God Emperor of Dune.
Did we want to start with Jack's story about his copy?
Oh, yeah. Let's do that. Jack, tell us about
what
happened and,
your
and what was spilled on your paperback copy.
Yeah, gladly. So I first read God Emperor of Dune in February, and in the lead up to the last episode, I reread it just because I wanted it to be fresh in my mind and I wanted to impress all of you.
Which you
I
did.
Had it in my.
Yep.
Well, thanks. Good. I'm glad I've pulled another con on the world.
Well, the fact that you actually read it instead of just listening to it on tape, like that's impressive in and of itself.
I don't trust those Dixian devices that play books on tape. But yeah, so I had it with me just sort of on my person throughout in the week leading up to this podcast. And I think it was on the Monday before the podcast was recorded on a Saturday. there was this bizarre like 10-minute deluge in DC that just, I got completely soaked, and then I took the book out and it was also complete, well, not completely soaked, but about half soaked. But I just thought that was hilarious, and it took me a bit to register. Like, wait a minute, my copy of God Emperor of Dune is water damaged. Go on to a podcast to discuss the book.
That's some kind of irony or something.
That's another one that the odds makers in Vegas probably would have worked with, I'm sure.
I like that story.
Yeah, so it was meant to be. But now, Megan, you can. For those who don't know why that's significant, I don't know why you're listening to this, but maybe Megan can help you figure that out.
Oh, I don't even know where to start. Somebody give me a place to start.
What was your initial impression?
Let's start at the very beginning.
My initial impression of this book is that it was not written for me. I got to the end and I thought, you know, I needed more punching.
Wow.
Yeah, I either need punching or I need a character that I care about and can connect with. And I didn't really get that in this book. I found a lot of the characters very annoying. Mostly in that they weren't terribly fleshed out, which just bothered me. Anyway,
wait a minute. Agola wasn't fleshed out?
The God Emperor is not fleshy enough for me.
That's funny. Ba-dum-ching.
I struggle with things that are like so political, and it was a lot of, and I just thought, I want you to show me more things, and I don't know. I kind of struggled with this one. So I didn't hate it, but I didn't like it. It was well written. I just didn't like it.
Wow.
So there are my initial thoughts. I have plenty that I can say. Like, there are so many things that I will be praising about this book. There are a lot of good things in it. I just think it wasn't necessarily written for me as an audience, which I think is weird because I thought I was the best person to write for.
Yeah.
I can be wrong sometimes.
I think we'll get to that.
We know, Todd thinks I'm wrong most of the time.
Okay, come on. Craig thinks you're wrong most of the time. I think you're wrong occasionally.
I know my value. Yeah.
I'm just going to stay in my lane over here.
You know, with that said, Jack, do you feel like, let's riff on that for just a second. Jack, as you're thinking about this book, do you feel like you were the target audience for this particular book?
I mean, I don't know. I don't always go into books thinking about whether they were made for me, but I didn't really know what to expect with God Emperor of Dune. But I was just, I'm a huge fan of it. It is my, as I elaborated sort of at length in the first God Emperor of Dune episode, it's my favorite since the first, and in some ways, some aspects of it are actually, I enjoy better than the first, so maybe it was the perfect, maybe I was the perfect audience, because I'm very susceptible to the type of character that the God Emperor is, the sort of sci-fi archetype of the omniscient being struggling to maintain contact with humanity. I'm a huge Duncan Idaho fan.
Testify.
The more, I feel like I have a fever and the only prescription is more Duncans. And there were plenty of Duncans in this one. Yeah, there were only two, but they loomed large. Well, there are only two in the actual book, but there are many, many more alluded to. And again, as I sort of went into in the last episode, it's almost comical, like the God Emperor's fixation on Duncan Idaho.
Well, yeah, like, they could have cloned anybody from back in his time, and they picked Duncan Idaho, who was somebody who missed like a very significant portion of the history.
I think there's a reason for that, but we won't talk about that today, I don't think.
The Duneverse runs on Duncans.
Well, it helps that Duncan is so loyal.
Now that's a good, that's well done.
That's well, especially because you're out there in DC where Duncan is.
Dunkin' Donuts are
owner. They own everything out there, don't they?
Oh, there are some. This is more. That's more a Boston thing. Boston runs on Duncan.
Yeah, they're crazy for Duncan.
So, Kenn, do you feel like you were the part of the target audience for this particular book?
No, not especially. Well, yes, in the sense that I am a fiction reader, you know, in terms of that I enjoy reading science fiction and fantasy. Yes, it is designed for me, as in, hey, here is a fiction book written by a legendary author. You should read it. In that sense, yes. The story, once I get into it, maybe it plods a little bit for me. I honestly did find a lot of the weavings, the political, I'm trying not to say machinations, but I'm going to say it anyway.
Say it.
The political machinations. There we go. A lot of the plots within plots to be interesting, at least interesting enough to keep my attention.
Plans within plans.
Plans within plans, yeah. And it's funny because the longer I go away from the book, the more I find myself wanting to read it again. So I guess in that sense, mission accomplished.
Yeah.
Because it's one that draws you back.
I think if I weigh in on the same question, I would have to say that I probably am the target audience. But I feel in some ways that this is one of those, this is a series, the book in the series that is probably the one that I find most interesting revisiting.
Well, and I thought it was interesting. I was thinking about it while I was driving over here about how I kind of wish that we had read this book first. And then treated all of the others as like a prequel.
Really?
And kind of been introduced that way, like coming in and reading God Emperor. And he he alludes to what Arrakis used to be and the blue in people's eyes because of all of the spice. And he, you know, this whole time in God Emperor of Dune, he's trying to get back to making the planet more deserty so that they can continue making the spice and it can be what it was.
So
probably
the worms
should have
can live
been.
Again. Yeah.
I don't know. I kind of just want to go back and read the other ones again to sort of be like, and this is where it all began.
Yeah.
So Megan, just because I want to hear you say that I am right.
Oh, here we go.
I'm crossing my fingers here. Would you agree with me from what I said last time that it feels like more of a palate cleanser from the first three are a trilogy and then this one is a divergence from that, and then
not having read the other three, I don't know.
No, I mean the three before it. You read those?
Yes, I do think it stands on its own.
Yeah,
we could call it a palate cleanser. I don't know if I would have used that phrase, but yeah, it kind of does stand on its own. You don't necessarily I got a lot more out of it having read the first three books, but I don't know that you necessarily need to.
Yeah,
this one, it could be its own thing.
Phew. So let's go ahead and yeah, she almost said you were right.
She almost said
she
I was
almost
right.
said you were right.
You make a good point.
I'll take it. I'll take it.
So let's go ahead and move on to another Reddit question. Do we have another one can talk about?
There were two. Well, one was my point, and one was one that we didn't get to last time from Twitter, and then he jumped over to Reddit. But okay. Jakob Lechner on Twitter.
Yep.
He wanted to compare Dune to The Wheel of Time. He saw several comparisons between Dune and The Wheel of Time. And interestingly enough,
can we do that without spoilers? Because I'm in the middle, or I'm like just beginning the seventh novel in The Wheel of Time.
Yes.
Okay.
And Jack,
can you do that without... No, I have not read Wheel of Time. So
okay, okay.
Have fun, guys.
I'm trying to figure out... Now I'm trying to make sure that I don't give anything away, but I really don't think that I would in the sense that they're pretty fundamental throughout the entire series. Like, for example, the biggest one being the Aes Sedai in The Wheel of Time and the Bene Gesserit in Dune. It's these two all-female, wizardy-type...
orchestrating.
Groups that... get their fingers into every pie and want to manipulate everything and just basically put their stamp of approval or disapproval on everything that's happening. So that's one. Rand and Paul are kind of the hero, yep. The savior type.
Rand Paul is the hero?
Rand Paul is the hero. Holy cow.
I wondered if you'd grab onto that one.
That's right. It all makes sense. Robert Jordan was right.
Rand Paul, 2020.
Rand Paul's going to save us all.
Okay.
Maybe he'll finally
Rand
run.
Rand Paul, 2020.
2020.
That's right. So similarities between Paul and Rand being the savior figure. I'm changing it there. The Fremen and the Aiel.
Oh yeah.
Both in the sense that they have that they're kind of a warrior people, a noble savage type people that has a prophecy of a chosen one, and here the chosen one shows up. Mm-hmm. So you got that. There are a couple of others. I want to reserve what I say because I don't want to spoil anything accidentally. So, but
sure.
But there are several similarities there, and of course there are similarities between Dune and Star Wars.
Oh yeah, well,
since Star Wars was greatly inspired by Dune, right, Jack?
That's one word for it.
Plagiarized is another one.
Certainly aspects were. I mean, when you're talking about Tatooine and Arrakis, and you're talking about the fact that Tatooine seems to be more pivotal in the series, in the Star Wars books, as things move on. We keep bringing everything back to Tatooine during the prequels, and it's not going to surprise me at all if the final Star Wars film winds up going back to Tatooine again. But I'll tell you this right now, if anybody starts making that into a desert lush paradise, I'm going to have a problem with it.
I'm going to say, though, I think it's interesting in Dune. It goes from being a desert planet to a paradise. Like, there's apparently no real in-between. Like, it's either a desert or it's, you know, or it's one. And I'm like, what?
3,000 years later, yeah.
3,000 years later. But
yeah, there's no,
I think it's interesting that there isn't a lot of variation. Like, planets have variation as far as, well, the only Class M planet I'm aware of is Earth. But it's got, you know, it's got water, yes, and it's got dry land, and it's, you know, has so many options. But that is not always the case in science fiction.
Yeah, single biome planets is kind of a weak archetype of sci-fi, but it's just so hard to like make a planet that's like, oh, there's desert here, there's forest here. Like, if you're a Star Trek director in the 60s, you can't make a planet like that. You just gotta have it be like a Nazi planet or something. That's much easier, much cheaper for the set guys to drag out like props from their World War II show.
Yeah,
right.
But I have a question about Wheel of Time. Okay. Is this a series in which the author also died before completing it?
Yes.
Or is he still alive? What's the one I'm thinking of?
No, that is true. Robert Jordan died before the series was completed.
And it was finished by Brandon Sanderson.
Yep.
So. Oh, yeah. So this is a warning to all of you aging fantasy and sci-fi authors out there.
Cough, George R. Martin, cough.
Finish your books.
Or hire Brandon Sanderson to do it. One or the other.
Brandon Sanderson or Kevin Anderson. So
yeah, or Kevin Anderson.
Kevin Anderson did a wonderful job with the rest of. Of course, the interesting thing I think is that with Robert Jordan and getting Brandon Sanderson, they just went forward with Dune bringing in Kevin J. Anderson. They went backwards. And they did all of the prequel setup for the Dune series, which I have not exposed you guys to yet, and may never do because your experience. Well, we got to get you through Heretics. We'll see what you think of Heretics. That's the next one. Okay. That's the next one.
I thought we were stopping at this one.
Well, we were, but I think we've changed our minds while you were not here.
She didn't listen closely
enough.
You
guys will really enjoy that. I'm really excited to hear what you guys have to say about that one.
We'll talk. We'll talk. I might be able to bribe you because I promise.
Said that about this one, but okay.
Well, I thought you'd get a kick out of the way that the God Emperor died. I guess not.
That's true. He had all these little worms popping out like adipose.
And he's cute. And I also thought that you'd get a kick out of the rock climbing scene, but obviously not.
Oh yeah, we laughed about this last time.
I know. I listened to the episode. It was a good one.
Oh,
and you guys
were
like, I just don't understand. I'm like, no, I could understand where that comes from. And also,
oh, really?
It gives poor Neela something to do because that character is so flat. She like literally like she sits at a computer. She walks around. She fires. Like she does nothing in this book. And I was like, OK, well, thank you for trying to flesh out her character just a little bit.
So
no
what you're
pun intended.
What I'm taking from all that, though, is you like rock climbing.
I mean, there. Yes.
I'm taking from that that you like watching people rock climb.
Back of people when they're active. That's all I'm gonna say.
Okay.
There's gonna be
reason
problems
why
for that.
I kind of enjoy football sometimes.
Respect.
There Respect. We go. Well, honesty. I'll take it. Kenn, do we have any other questions from Reddit that we need to take a look at before we dive into the next questions that I have?
Because mine
are probably not going to be near as much fun.
I'm very interested to hear your questions, actually.
So, with that said, let me grab my notes. Oh.
While you're grabbing your notes, I do want to point out something that I didn't get enough time to mention last time, and that's the role of Ganema in developing, I think, in developing the universe post-Leto. Meaning, we talked a lot about how he was trying to breed the prescience out of the universe, basically. Yeah. That's what he was doing. And I think that him breeding Ganema with, what was the guy's name? Not Oksana.
Harak.
Harak Aladar.
Harak Aladar, I think it was, wasn't it?
Something like that. But I think...
The last of the Carinos.
I feel like
Leto
knew. Yeah,
the one
who
gets Bene Gesserited.
Yes, right. But I feel like Leto knew that Ganema had that ability, that lack of prescience. I mean, she was prescient, obviously, but mm-hmm. I think he saw that she had that in her genetics, which is part of the reason Paul didn't know she was there.
That's interesting.
And I think that's why she was so instrumental in the Golden Path.
That is interesting.
And I guess I thought the reason that she couldn't be seen was because, like the rest of, like so many others of the Atreides, her existence was hidden from those with prescience, from those others with prescience, because the guild navigators couldn't see anyone going forward. Paul could see Leto because he had seen that he would have, that Chani would have, or Chani would have children, but did not see Ganema because she was hidden.
Right.
So I wonder if really Ganema was supposed to be the Kwisatz Haderach, and Leto stole that particular prize away from his sister.
Hey.
Wow. You snooze. I did not pick up subtlety well. All right.
Yeah,
sorry,
the last was the last sentences of the last words spoken in Children of Dune are Ganema. And she says that one of us was always going to have to bear the burden, and he was always the stronger. And then we don't hear from her except by inference in God Emperor of Dune at all. But even though she is sort of instrumental in creating, since here I go back to the gross protuberance, since Leto II can't reproduce, she's got to carry the Atreides line forward. So right. In a sense, she's at least as important as, or is she, I won't say at least as important, but she bears tremendous significance in this narrative in the future of the Dune universe. But it's not, she doesn't get to be a main character in this book because she didn't cover herself with worm goo like her brother did.
Well, and I wonder if there is a difference. And this would be one of those places where a study of what Brian Herbert meant with the Bene Gesserit and the way that their breeding program worked, if there were differences in the way that, because Duncan keeps mentioning, I will not be your stud. You can't just use me to reproduce. And of course, the God Emperor has done that for 3,000 years. Mm-hmm. But I wonder if there was a fundamental difference in what the women would bring to those breeding programs versus what the men would bring to the breeding programs and the way that worked. That's a question I'm not sure has an answer. Of course, having said that, I'm sure somebody out there in the Reddit verse will have an answer for me and say, well, on such and such a date, this is what we learned, and I'll gladly retract my words.
Say, sure,
say,
okay.
Great, not that a problem. Especially if it gets people to go to Reddit.
That's right. So anyway, thank you for looking for your notes so that I could, you know, interject that.
Yeah. So here's the first question that I had that I wanted us to talk a little bit about. Now, most of us, and Jack, you're over the age of 25, right?
I just turned 26.
Okay. Okay. So yes, you're
about
over
a month ago. Close enough. A month ago, exactly a month ago.
Okay. So you're over 25.
Merry on birthday.
And Kenn and Megan and I are all also over the age of 25. So we've pretty much lived in a world that has had Dune as part of the science fiction landscape most of our lives. But we also have the ability to go back and look at and read and sometimes watch science fiction and science fiction movies that were created prior to Dune. I'm thinking of things like Star Trek, Lost in Space. Mm-hmm. We've also got 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. We've got Starship Troopers. We've got quite a bit of science fiction that existed before, that we've encountered,
especially that we've encountered here on the podcast, mm-hmm. and science fiction that has existed after. Have you, other than the obvious ones that we've already talked about with the Tatooine and Arrakis and some of those kinds of things, what things have you seen change or be changed as in science fiction as a result of Dune? Have you guys thought about that at all? I'll give you an example of one that I have. And that is that politics is a major piece of most of the science fiction that I see moving forward. Mm-hmm. A lot of the science fiction that I was seeing crafted before, I think the best, one of the best examples of that is in two of the three versions of Lost in Space. The Lost in Space in the 1960s, late 50s, early 60s, mm-hmm. And the Lost in Space of the 1990s. You remember that one?
Yep. Oh yeah, that was awesome.
And that Jack's
Weird.
Laughing.
Is that the
at
one
me.
Where Gary Oldman turns into a spider?
It yeah. sure is.
That's the one.
I saw that on a really good
okay,
date.
I have your premise, like hazy recollections of that part of the movie.
Your premise is stunted when you trust Matt LeBlanc to fly your spaceship.
So I remember Matt LeBlanc. In fact, I remember part of the reason that he had to put that he is the only one that had a spacesuit that covered his face is because there were filming conflicts between that film and Friends.
Sure.
And then, you know, but
yeah, because and Gary Oldman was also in an episode of Friends.
He was.
Yeah, that's right.
He was. But in those two films, or in those two pieces of science fiction, in the first one, there is no mention of the politics going on in the world at all. But in the second one, the very opening sequence is all about the politics of a group of terrorists trying to destroy the space gate and the political unrest on the planet that has been caused by the enormous expenditures of trying to do this trip through space and try and get to some place where we can colonize because we've destroyed our planet with all of the things that we've done horribly to it, blah, 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 blah.
That is true.
And so for me, one of the things that I've seen change about science, because you watch any good Star Trek mm-hmm. and when you get right down to it, in the 1960s Star Trek, there is no mention at all whatsoever of political intrigue inside the Federation.
That's true. There are a lot of there's a lot of commentary on social issues, but not so much the political.
Yeah.
The exception to this being Mirror Mirror, which is in which the dark universe is only political intrigue, but that's not the Federation.
Yes. Correct. Correct.
I feel like it's not there was no political intrigue, there was no political commentary or social commentary back then. I feel like the difference is subtlety. No longer are you, slipping that in there and letting people infer what they will from it or go, this can be an allegory for this comment or for this social issue. This can be a representation of that. Now it is just pure browbeating. This is what I mean. And you will understand and accept my point of view.
So this is how democracy dies.
Well, are you saying that's something that's modern? Because Star Trek could be pretty browbeaty.
It could, but
just remember the episode that had the Riddler actor in it. That was like,
oh yeah, Frank Gorshin.
Oh really? Is this a metaphor for race relations? Oh, I
that's right.
I wasn't sure.
As you notice, we are completely different. He is black on the left.
That's right.
I refer to that episode all the time.
It's one of my favorite ones.
Very weird.
One of my favorites. That one, Mirror Mirror. And well,
the one
basically,
with the pizza monster.
Basically all of them.
Well,
they were all my favorite.
And maybe it's the fact that it is old and I am less old, but it didn't feel as hammer to a nail, you know.
Well, yeah. it's also interesting to think about how technology in our society has evolved, where just in the last, I guess, 50 or 60 years, where, you know, back in the 50s, the best way to get a hold of somebody was by telephone, but people only had like one telephone in their house. Right. And you get to the 80s and every teenager has a telephone in her room, apparently. And
didn't. Are you still a little bitter about that?
No, I did.
I sense bitterness.
but then your brother had a telephone, too, and he could get on the line and he could frustrate your conversation.
Wah, wah. But like as we in the 80s, like information was a lot easier to get, and there were more televisions and people, and there were more channels on television, and it was easier to get access to information. So I think people became a lot more politically aware. And Frank Herbert obviously grabbed on that and created this. It could be an allegory. I don't know. I just like to say allegory. Allegory.
So while we're talking about technology, I think so. The sense I get of the Dune's impact on science fiction is that it kind of got, it forced the whole genre to work a little harder.
Yes.
Because, and here's why I think this. The whole Butlerian Jihad, which in the original run of novels, it's never really fully fleshed out, but it's always in the background explained. Yes. Like we had this almost religious crusade against thinking machines.
Mm-hmm.
And so that forced Frank Herbert away from a lot of the like low-hanging sci-fi fruit. Like he couldn't deal with any Asimovian robot stuff. Didn't really have like high technology aside from spaceships, which you need, and like ships to harvest the spice. So what he had to do was bring the human element to prominence again, or it's all human basically, the human element, and make it interesting, and make like the human element, and then also the other thing, if technology is kind of out of the picture, or not, if not completely out of the picture, then restrained, then the planet itself in which this action takes place has to become more interesting. And like half of Dune is really about the ecology of Arrakis, which
yes.
is something that was kind of new to sci-fi at the time, but now everyone's like, oh, got really complicated planets unless they just do single biome planets because they're lazy. So I think those would be two big effects, is the making the human element more interesting by restraining the like whiz-bangery that was a lot of sci-fi in the early days, was kind of like, oh, what if we had this really cool thing? What would that be like? And also just treating a planetary environment like an actual environment. Like, okay, we have an entire planet that's a desert. How did it become a desert? What keeps it a desert? What lives in the desert? Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Cool. I love it.
Well, and I think of things like the oral histories, and I was unclear as to whether that was a written history, if it was the true oral histories that one or more persons in the society had to learn and then would repeat to the children often, because Leto he talked with Sayona a lot about, you know, well, if you've read the oral histories, or if you've, you know, if you know the oral histories, you know that I said this, or you know that this is a thing that I care about. And they refer to that a lot. And I just thought it's, you know, when you don't have a computer to write things down, or when you don't have, do they have a printing press? I don't know. He has written journals that she steals at some point, but how in the world?
Yeah, Maneo actually has an illegal computer. Remember?
Because
at one point in God Emperor of Dune, he's like in his office secretly typing away and musing like, oh, this would be, if anyone knew I had this, I would be killed or something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's another thing that's pretty interesting for me, at least, in the way that Dune treats technology is, Leto II says this at some point, and I can't remember if we talked about this, but the idea that a people are easier to control when they have to walk.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And,
oh, yeah, we talked a lot about this in the last episode.
Yeah, we talked about that.
And the idea that...
The population that walks is easier to control.
Yep. The idea that the technology, the impact of technology and of the ability to travel in Dune is something that he treats as a piece of control. But throughout much of the rest of science fiction, the goal is to travel. The goal is to escape. The goal is to go someplace else.
It's true.
And I wonder if...
Yeah, what's the Heinlein novel, Have Starship, Will Travel?
Have Spacesuit, Will Travel.
Spacesuit. That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so there's a lot of this... he's done a wonderful job of creating a star-spanning empire that all of the interesting things happen on one planet. Okay, I guess that one we have to give back to George Lucas for having stolen. But most of the rest of the science fiction that we consume on a regular basis is about and deals very specifically with the technology used to do that travel. all of the planetary stuff is left alone. It's the space that they explore. Whereas Frank Herbert did a really wonderful job of setting all of the technology in such a way that it was the land that was explored. Mm-hmm. But he also does something that is, again, it's become a trope a little bit in science fiction. And that's his eugenics program. The same thing that the Bene Gesserit were doing, the same thing that he was doing. All of this breeding for particular characteristics and traits.
Which is fascinating to me because you mentioned in the last episode that they are not sexually inhibited peoples. Where it's like, oh yeah, Duncan, you can sleep with anybody you want. And except for Hui, don't sleep with her. and yet he cares so much about certain people's specific, like you have to mate with this person and you have to do this with this person. And then everybody else is like, oh, whatever. Look at all these little kids running around with my fish speakers. They're so cute. I guess you can retire. You've got six kids. That's fine. Also, I did appreciate that Duncan finally did get his Jessica, even if it wasn't the Duncan that we knew.
Wow. Okay. Okay.
I thought that was kind of nice.
I wonder if that was a wink or a nod. I don't know. What do you think about now, one of the questions I ask, I have frequently asked as we're talking about science fiction is, in what way do you see science driving the fiction? And in this book, that was my big question. I've kind of given you maybe a little bit of a glimpse as to what I think it is possibly the answer, but what do you guys think? In what way does the science drive I'm filibustering a little bit to let you think, because I'm seeing all of your faces think and all of your wheels turning. I have struggled when people look at me and say, oh, that's really good science fiction, and I look at them and I say, no, that's really good space opera. That's not necessarily science fiction, because in order for me to say that something is science fiction, I want to see how the science drives the fiction.
Well, I don't.
Not just that it's not just that it's put in the future, or just that it's put in space. It's got to have something about the science that drives the fiction.
I don't know if it's necessarily a specific scientific thing that drives the fiction in this, more of a scientific concept, in that of genetic breeding, genetic manipulation, or societal manipulation based on genetic, you know, manipulation. A lot of manipulation in there, but it's something that has been toyed with, and we get better at, you know, in terms of actual science, where we can program out certain characteristics, yeah, certain defects. We see that something is going to be wrong, and we can correct it in utero before that child is born now. And so I can see, in terms of that concept, Leto's whole breeding program driving society forward, because his whole point in being for 3,500 years is nudging society, nudging humanity one way or another, so that it all gets on this perfect one little path where society will survive somehow. Which I still have a problem with, by the way. This is a little bit of a tangent. The whole idea that, okay, now I have perfected society and now it will survive. You can't know that. You can't, you cannot program for the human element, for the human condition. Somebody will inevitably go and screw that up, or somebody in the last 3,500 years will probably have done something to ensure that humanity survived. Anyway, that was the biggest problem I had with the whole Golden Path thing in the first place. But short story long, I think that the idea of genetic programming is what is the science that drives this story.
Okay. Jack, how about you?
So I think I want to go sort of bigger picture here, because really the whole, you sort of alluded to this with the bit about the population that walks is easier to control. Really the whole modus operandi of this book is that the sort of intimate relationship between the knowledge, the collective knowledge that a society possesses, and the level to which it can advance as a civilization.
Okay.
So it's really like the how do I put this? The level at which the Dune universe finds itself is sort of determines where it exists on the, this is such an abstract point. I'm struggling to find concrete terms for it. But the best thing I can do for this is to analogize to another book that makes this point for me. Have any of you read?
Did we lose you for a second? There you are.
Either.
You're coming back.
Oh, what was the last thing you heard me say?
We heard you say, "Have any of you read?" And then you stopped.
Oh, really? What a cliffhanger!
And I wanted to be sarcastic, and be like, "Yes." Anyway.
Have any of you read Canticle for Leibowitz?
No.
Or heard of it?
No. I've heard of it, but I haven't read it.
It's one of my favorite books, and it is similar to God Emperor of Dune in the respect that it has a gigantic timeline and treats the questions of civilizational survival and transmission of knowledge.
Oh no, you're cutting out again.
Ways that these are coterminous. These are the same real problem, really. And the God Emperor controls the civilization by controlling what the civilization is allowed to know. He's like the fount of knowledge for the whole thing. He controls its advance by doling pieces out here and there. Nothing happens beyond his ambit that is not within his permission. So really, it's like a statement about how, in the terms of science driving the fiction, it's literal. The science, the level of advancement that the civilization is allowed to achieve determines where it exists and where it will go next. And so that's like a very, it's sort of consonant with the early sci-fi and its obsession with progress and like, we need to build all these cool things so we can live on Mars. But I think Herbert brings a bit more of a, he brings more of a nuanced edge to it, because he thinks about things in a bit of a longer term, thinks about the risks of that technology can pose, that science can pose, and how someone would go about mitigating them. Again, in a sort of extreme fashion in this book, but it's still something worth considering.
Yeah, I like it.
Well, and building on that, I was thinking about the psychology of the thing, where he has been around for 3,500 years and he knows people.
Yeah.
And yes, every once in a while he's surprised, but he knows exactly how to test Siona so that she gets on his side. He knew how to test Maneo. And it wasn't the same. It was in a very different way. And he's able to personalize those things. And yeah, I'm sure that there were pairings where people were supposed to mate and they didn't want to, but he knew how to make it happen. He knew how to manipulate people and he knew the psychology of people. I think also the science fiction, I guess we already kind of talked about it, how it's driven by the land, but the fact that it goes from being a desert planet into like slowly being created into
a paradise,
a foresty place. But the whole plan is for him to get that back to the desert, or at least give more space for the little baby worms. I can't think of what they're called.
The sand trout.
Thank you.
Little makers.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, no. Different.
Yeah.
Sorry.
So the other one that I and as I've dug more into the book, I think the genetics, the controlling of information, I think those are really interesting themes that run through that. There's obviously the environmental themes that run through there are there as, I think, as stark warnings, but they also touch in a different area, and that is how one thing can change everything with either its presence or its absence. And that is the spice.
Mm-hmm.
And Jack, I don't know if you'd I'm sure you've seen this in other places, but I don't know if we ever talked about the fact that in one of our early episodes, we talked about the way that the spice is, compared very, very frequently to petroleum products. To fuel, to the way that spice, you know, they talk about how spice is used in how spice showed up in everything on Arrakis, and it showed up in everything in the empire, at a point. And I remember the other day I was thinking about how much petroleum we use in my house. And I thought, well, you know, I've got to start cutting back. And I thought, well, where can I start cutting back? Because
because when I start talking, you know, until I'm, unless I'm going to go to, because some of my favorite clothing is made with polyesters and rayon and some artificial fabrics that are created from petroleum distillates. And so, okay, well then I've got to switch someplace else. And omnipresence and dependence on petroleum I wonder how much Frank Herbert was really pushing this idea to make us all consider the fact that our overdependence upon petroleum, in the same way that the overdependence on the spice, keeps a people from really being able to move forward. I don't know. He's not here.
He who controls the spice controls the universe.
Thank you, Baron Vladimir Harkonnen.
Yeah. That was me trying to do the unhinged Harkonnen from the movie.
I did think it was interesting that he didn't ever mention the Baron, but I felt like he probably drew upon the Baron in order to be, I mean, he was not exactly a benevolent ruler. No. Yeah. But
there is an allusion to the Baron right at the beginning. Yeah. I didn't know this offhand. I just happened. This is very easy to find. Don't be impressed with me. This is Leto giving his sort of like pseudo biblical introduction when he talks about his ancestry. So he's done that, and then he says, "My paternal grandfather died, as many good Greeks did, attempting comfortably now in my ancestral memories." So he is there, but he's uncomfortable.
Yes. Yeah, and it is a fascinating it is a fascinating weaving through the story of being able to keep all of these people, including the ancient Greeks as well as all of the modern mythic heroes that Frank Herbert wants to put together, how he gets them all playing on the same battlefield of passion, of control, and of trying to help civilization, society move forward. I think he does a good job. So I guess before we get into the last question, because I want to ask Megan if she's got any scenes that are going to stand out, and if we want to make any adjustments on the predictions that we might see in Heretics of Dune. But I want to ask the question that I started alluding to by talking about petroleum. Does this book have any warnings that resonate to you that you would say to yourself, On a level three piece, and remember, level one being a really good story, level two being about politics, and I think we've been very clear that there's a lot of political information, a lot of things that we can think about politically, but level three being about how we live, are there any really powerful, and what it means to be human, what it means to be a good human, are there any real level three things that jumped out at you about this book?
For me, I had a couple things. One is I found the whole the concept of the fish speakers very interesting, where Leto decided to have women be the military or his bodyguards.
Mm-hmm. Oh boy! I deliberately was like, we don't have to talk about this.
Yeah,
to go into a lot of detail, but I just think that it was interesting that he purposely wanted these women, and he wasn't worried about them. Oh no, we have to sterilize them so that they can just be warriors. But he wanted mothers. He wanted women who appreciated life because they've given life, and they've, like, you know, birth is a difficult process and you can die. And so he wanted these people who really understood the miracle that life is, to help to protect him and to protect his people, because they are less likely to kill when they do appreciate life. And I think one of the scenes that really stands out to me is where they're doing the Sayanok ceremony,
yes,
for lack of a better term. And
you mean the Holy Sacrament to Leto, the gross protuberance?
Yes, that one. and he has all of these fish speakers come in who are about to retire. And they have children of varying ages. And in my mind, I sat there and I just thought, you know, here are these women who are putting themselves in harm's way to protect their life, to protect their god emperor, the god of the spice. And I don't know, that said a lot. And I just sat there and I'm like, well, if they're taking care of the No, if they're being the warriors, who's taking care of the kids and who's, you know, and I want to be a strong woman who can help to defend the people I care about against the evil in the world.
Okay. Well, and I think I don't think anybody would say that. Let me rephrase. I think the image for me of the most fearsome creature on the planet is a mother grizzly bear with someone in between her and her cub.
Yeah.
And so when Leto makes that choice and everybody says, well, you know, aren't they going to be, you know, how can they be trusted to be the strong ones and mm-hmm. the tough ones? I'm sitting there and I'm thinking to myself, yeah, obviously I haven't gone to Yellowstone and had to watch a mother grizzly bear run across a field and say to yourself, boy, I'm glad I'm not in between that mother and her cub. Yeah. And yeah, I've seen that. So that's kind of interesting. Thank you. I appreciate that. Jack, how about you? Any level three stuff that you found in this book?
This makes no sense given that I'm not really that old yet, but the whole, the God Emperor's obsession, obsession is the wrong word. It's a rational thing. He's extremely concerned and very deliberate about his relationship to posterity.
Mm-hmm.
And perhaps he is uniquely positioned to have this obsession because of all of the past experiences that are contained within him and all of the future happenings that he knows are on their way. But I am, as I age, as I grow old, I'm increasingly conscious of myself in the stream of history, where I am and what will come after me, whether I'll have a legacy at all.
Mm-hmm.
And this is something that the God Emperor is very concerned with. And he, in fact, is predicting, he seems almost conscious of something. Oh, wait, I won't say what happens in Heretics of Dune, but he predicts that that subsequent generations will despise him, but then eventually realize what he was doing and thank him. I don't know if that will be true of my posterity, but we'll find out, I guess. But just the idea of being the sort of hyper consciousness he has of the past and the future and the present and the concern with posterity, that's something I strongly related to. I'm not sure if it inclined me to make myself a better person, because I certainly wouldn't want to employ Leto-esque methods to guard my legacy, even if they were available to me, which I don't think they are. If you guys find
you're
any
only
Melon,
25,
let me know.
So, okay.
Well, trust me, if I find any melange, I'm certainly not going to be giving it to you first.
Yeah. I want you to finish your thought.
Your
mother. Okay. It is interesting, though.
No, that's all I had to say.
Okay, good. Sorry, I was interrupting you. I one of the things that Leto, I mean, you were talking about how you're not sure that you'd want to be as, you know, strict or as harsh as Leto has to be sometimes. And Leto is very aware of it, and I think he knows that there is a need for that. It's like a parent who, I'm not your friend, I'm your mom. You know, you have to put your foot down every once in a while. And he, when talking of Mineo at one point, he refers to himself as a... What's that?
Or your gross protuberance.
Ew. He talks about how he is the predator. And he says, the predator improves the stock by picking off the weak. Or at least I put in the by picking off the weak. Which makes everything else stronger. So yeah. Sometimes you do have to bring down the hammer in order to help somebody to learn the lesson that they have to, or not throw down the hammer in order for your child to learn the lesson that they need to.
Yeah. I think for me, I'll be honest, I really, and I think I mentioned this last time too, I really struggled to find very much level three,
mm-hmm.
in this book. There were some places where I could see some level one. This for me was a huge level two. It was a huge pursuit through level two. But if there were some moments of level three, one of them was that for me at least was to remember that choices have consequences,
mm-hmm.
And that there are some choices that are difficult choices to make that must be made. And while that works very well for a level two kind of a deal. It also works very well for a level three, because there are times when I have been faced with, especially as it deals with family and children, there are times that I am faced with choices that while unpleasant, must be made in particular directions. And they can span in very trivial things to very momentous things. But I also recognize, as I am looking at those kinds of choices, that I have to weigh, I have to be careful as I'm making those choices, that I weigh them based on the outcomes, based on their intended consequences. Because if I'm only doing it based on the desirability of the choice, mm-hmm. I'll never make them. And I think Leto mentions that at a couple of points when he talks about how his father shied away from it because he couldn't give up his humanity. He couldn't give up his Chaney. But he was willing to give up his humanity. He was willing to do this for the good of humanity. And I'm not sure it necessarily did him any favors. Yeah. But I certainly recognize that is something that I will carry away from me from this book, of being able to say choices have consequences. We have to be in, and when you're making choices, sometimes as unpleasant as those choices might be, you have to make them based on the outcomes that you intend for them to create.
Which is just fascinating, just thinking that he made this choice when he was 9. And yes, he was a remarkable child. Was he 11? I don't know, but he was a child when he made this choice. Yep. And mm-hmm. he reflects often on, you know, I'm fine. I don't really need my gross protuberance. That's cool. And then he meets Hui and he realizes, like, this is the woman he would have wanted to share his life with if she had been available. Like, if he had met her back at that point, would things have been different? And I struggle with Hui. I just feel like she has no personality. She's just, like, so sweet. And I can't.
Yeah, she's not a...
Go ahead.
She's not a great character, especially because the... I don't know if Herbert originated this trope of the super being kind of tethered to humanity by this one thread. It's very similar to the Watchmen plot.
Yes.
With Dr. Yeah. Manhattan and the Silk Spectre. Hui as this, like, when I read, every time Hui is in the narrative, I'm like, oh, so this is the one thing keeping the God Emperor tethered to humanity? Really? This? Like,
well, yeah. And okay. She's just so willing to sacrifice, like, her whole life and everything because she feels sorry for him. Like, yes, pity is a way that love can start and it can develop, but also...
Except when Duncan's in the room.
Yeah. Ah, Duncan. I struggle because I'm thinking of Jabba the Hutt, and in my mind, Hui is Hayley Atwell's character from Cinderella. And she's just like the loveliest, sweetest thing ever. And I'm like, I just don't see the two of them together. See? And neither can anybody else in the novel, but
yeah,
it makes me crazy.
Yeah, I would agree.
I just thought Hui was dull. Nothing happened with Nayla. I don't know.
Well, we're getting close to our time for the length of our episode, but I wanted to take just a couple of seconds. Megan, we didn't get an opportunity to ask you if there is a scene that you will take with you from this book. Is there anything that you will say, yep, I'm going to remember that little exchange. That one's going to stick with me.
Ooh.
If you say rock climbing, I swear.
I wasn't going to say that. I think I've already talked about it. It's the one with all of the fish speakers with their children.
And the Sea Anonymous.
And also, actually, now that you mention it, the scene where Sayana takes Duncan to the little village where previous Duncan had his family. And the little boy comes running up and he's so excited. And all of a sudden he looks at Duncan and says, "You're not him." And he just knows, "You're not my dad." And then he knows that his dad has died.
Something like that happened to me when a dog, I was walking by a house and this dog, there was a fenced in yard, and a dog got really excited to see me, and its owner was out, or one of its owners was out. And then when the owner saw how excited the dog was getting, the owner said, "That's not who you think it is." And I assumed that the dog, she assumed that the dog mistook me for the other owner, but I was just so bummed. I was like, man, I'm really, why'd you have to make that dog so bummed?
Want to play with that dog? Yes, come on.
That was a good scene.
Yeah.
That was a good scene.
Yeah.
So, Jack, any adjustments or predictions that you think people should look forward to if they do decide to venture into Heretics of Dune? You've already read Heretics, haven't you?
Yeah, so I'm trying to think how I can expand slightly upon the almost spoiler I gave earlier.
What would you tell Megan to try and convince her to read the book?
Well, that's going to be hard because, I won't say too much about Heretics, but I will say that the question of whether posterity will respect the legacy of Leto II will be answered by Heretics of Dune.
Yes.
That is something that will be answered. So you should expect that to be addressed in Heretics of Dune.
We lost you on buffering again. We got you back, but we lost you when you said, and then it stopped.
Well, that doesn't help him know where he was.
I know, it doesn't help us either. And it looks like, there we go.
So what was the last thing you heard me say before the
You'd said that Heretics would answer the question as to whether or not they were going to respect his legacy.
Okay, and the other question is whether the God Emperor is in Heretics of Dune. Like, not just his legacy, but like him. Because he's not, in God Emperor, we learn that he's not going to completely die. So
that's true.
What is he, what's left of him physically in Arrakis in the future? I don't know.
Yeah.
Tune in next time to find out.
Yeah. Same bat time, same bat channel. Any guesses, Megan? You really don't even care, do you?
I really don't.
Yeah.
I'm okay. So sorry.
That's okay. I will save any of my spoilery stuff and just say this. As a blue team, we're going to have a conversation, a long conversation about this. I think that there is some value and that some of you will be really thrilled to finish and read Heretics of Dune, and some of us will not. So we'll talk about it. We'll decide what we're going to do. And we'll publish that. We'll let you know what we're going to be reading next, whether we're going to pick up another Dresden, or if we're going to do Heretics of Dune, or maybe if we're going to do both. What a thought.
What?
Yeah. There's always a possibility that we might be able to pull off a little bit more. Maybe we'll do that as a Patreon exclusive, for those that would like to finish off the series. We'll kind of see how that goes. We'll talk about it and we'll let you know. In the meantime, I just want to thank you all for listening, for taking the time. Hopefully we've made your experience with Dune and with this magnificent series a little more enjoyable.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see you next time. All right, Jack, you ready?
Hold on one second. Let me.
Do you want me to hold on too?
All right, I am ready now.
I must not delay. Follow your guys' lead. The podcast killer.
I got my water damaged copy of God Emperor of Dune right here, and I'm gonna mention this time that it was water damaged. I keep forgetting to tell people that.
Was it that way when you bought it, or did you drop something on it?
No, it happened.
I
can explain if you cue me in. I can explain what happened because it's very relevant to this.
I think we should start with that.
I think we will start with that.